and the most difficult sacrifice. As by the famous quote of Napoleon Bonaparte, it is the cause, not the death, that makes the martyr. The life of late Sri Sanjay Kumar Singh in creating himself in our memories forever is a simple measurement of the commitment, sacrifice, and pain one endures to achieve a dream. I am privileged to welcome Dr. Kiran Bedi, Honorable Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry, the chief guest of today's event. Ma'am will be joining with us shortly. I also welcome Sri Bharat Jyoti, Director, Indira Gandhi National Forest Academy, Sri Sushil Kumar Avasthi, Additional Director, IGNFA, Sri Mukul Trivedi, Professor, IGNFA, parents and family members of late Sri Sanjay Singh, heads of sister institutions and organizations, dear faculty members, senior IFS officer, esteemed guests, IFS probationers of 2019 and 2020 batch, ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening to you all. I deem it an honor and privilege to give brief life profile of late Sri Sanjay Kumar Singh, in whose memory we are all have gathered here today. Late Sri Sanjay Singh was born on 13th September 1967 at Belhami Jairam village of Sitamarhi district of Bihar to Dr. Ghanshyam Narayan Singh and Dr. Kanti Singh. The only son of his parents, he was married to Ms. Anupriya Singh in 1996 and blessed with a daughter, Onal, and a son, Samrat. He did B.Tech in Textile Engineering from IIT Delhi, Master in Computer Applications from JNU, New Delhi. He qualified for Indian Forest Service in 1991 and joined the 1992 to 1994 course in IGNFA, where he displayed meritorious performance by securing several gold and silver medals for extraordinary achievements in various disciplines and co-curricular activities. He was allotted to Bihar State Cadre, where he did exemplary work in checking illegal mining and collection of tendu leaves. He was uncompromising on basic principles, which is evident from the fact that he lodged a number of FIRs against offenders, including administrative officials, despite tremendous pressure from various corners. He also paid special attention to generate employment for poor people under various afforestation and other development projects. On February 15, 2002, he proceeded to inspect the construction work of a recently built road in Sasaram Division, Bihar. After reaching the Rehal range office, some armed men in police dress asked him to stop, questioned him and demanded money as commission for road being constructed. Sanjay Singh denied their demands. There was a heated argument, but soon the goodwill of Sanjay Singh for the villagers through the construction of road, school buildings and primary health centers overcame it, and all villagers gathered there in his support. But the armed men started firing and separated Sri Sanjay Singh from all other forest officials and moved into the forest, and then they fired at him. This marked the end of life of an honest and courageous forest officer to whom the highest tribute is not grief, but the gratitude. To immortalize the memory of Sanjay Kumar Singh, the Sanjay Kumar Singh Memorial Trust, a registered non-profit public charitable trust, has been formed to support the activities related to the cause of protection of forest and the environment. In addition to this, a government college in Kaimur district, a park at Sasaram, has been named after him. State-level organization and media conferred him with the title of Shaheed. His parents have donated his medals to IGNFA so as to perpetuate his memory. Every year, a memorial lecture is organized here at IGNFA in the memory of late Sri Sanjay Kumar Singh. There is a Sanjay Singh Memorial Gold Medal awarded every year to the IFS probationer for ranking first in the subject of forest management and environmental conservation. Nothing said or done can bring back this nation's brave son. But each year, Sanjay Kumar Singh Memorial Lecture is organized at IGNFA in a humble effort to pay homage to the memory of his brave man and to honor his timeless sacrifice. May I now request Dr. Ghanshyam Singh, father of late Sri Sanjay Singh, to deliver his message to the gathering. Please, sir.
Me? Is it me?
Sir, please unmute and go and speak, sir.
हम नहीं कर सकते
that is coming up. Are you getting me?
Yes.
Are you getting me, please?
We can hear you, sir.
Unmuted, Kadi.
Yes, sir, we can't hear you, sir. We can't speak.
लाइन तो कर दिया था ना, आवाज नहीं आ रहा उनका।
There is some technical problem, I think. Are you getting me?
हाँ सर।
Yes, sir, we are getting you, sir. Please go ahead.
Should I start right now?
Yes, sir.
Oh, thank you very much, the director, all the faculty members, and the young professionals coming from all over the country. It is one moment where I become more sentimental and emotional. However, all the time since the lecture was initiated, I have been coming on a physical way to address the people and inspire them. As you know, the pandemic, COVID-19, forget to mention what I would like to say a few words about Kiran Bedi itself, because she is one lady officer of all India, known all over the country. Well, I don't want to be so illustrative, but I simply say all the time I become very emotional, and I feel whenever I come to your Indira Gandhi Forest Academy, I feel all the cadets that are coming up, they all are my Sanjam. I feel Sanjay's face in all of you. So it gives a lot of inspiration, and it gets paid back also. Paid back in the sense, wherever you go, in any of the part, which is very frequent to deliver my lecture on my academic pursuits, I find forest officers, senior officers, and all that, they used to connect me when they see my program anywhere. They used to connect me and they used to come. Recently, I was in, say, last year in December, I was in Bengaluru, and there to address a conference in a meeting, and I found a senior officer, forest officer there. He saw my name there, and he came back. He asked the director that he wants to connect me. And he came to me to pay my respect. And at that time only you will know that one of the very, very, very popular website journal that is called The Better India, that has given a wide coverage of Sanjay's deed. And Sanjay was declared the achievers in the world, achiever officers in the world. I say I inspire all the young professionals to become Sanjay like that. I don't want you to sacrifice the sacrifice which Sanjay did, because that was a maximum thing which he. But anyway, in spite of that, doing that way, you can do your service in a better way, otherwise also, and I believe you all will emulate the deed which Sanjay did for the forest life, the silent life and all that. And it has been adored, it has been adored by various forum, be it your own academy. Here today only I see that a program is going on. They are at what we call Sanjay Singh, Sahi Sanjay Singh Memorial College. I will be sending the photographs that have been sent from there only. That is in one of the area, in that area only, one of the colleges, which was earlier a Mahila college, has been renamed on the demand of the people, the Shahid Sanjay Singh Mahila College. And this is the love and affection of the people of the area where he did your work. And wherever you go and you do something, you must do exceptionally better one. Better it means only you have to be very perfect in your own job, and that is enough for anybody to do it, and that one can do. So you should be not the one among the esteemed. Especially, you see, that for making your presence in the society, you should do something which is better and which is against the current. Currently, everybody is doing the job, protecting the forest, protecting the mining and all that. But the thing is that which sincerity, which devotion, which dedication you do the work, that is very important. I believe all the young professors, I see all the faces there, and I believe that each one in the faculty, whenever I go there, I feel a personal, I wish to address everybody by name, but since it is a virtual one, I couldn't find who among the faculty is there, and whosoever is not there, I address them also and say simply one word, that is, be yourself sincere to your devotion, and my love to you all is because my connection with Sanjay. Sanjay was one of the very bright that you all know, but he did something exceptionally. I say, most of the time when I go there, I become very emotional. That emotion, I overcome it, because my emotion is a personal, but more important is what you do for the society, and that is to be remembered. I remember Sanjay because he was a special in the society. And society is very grateful that way. Today also, here there is a state forest guest house, where minister went there to address the Sanjay Memorial Lecture. He even, minister was, fortunately, I don't remember whether he knows me, but he was knowing me. He called me that please come. And because time was very short, I couldn't go. And here at my residence, for the first time, in his memory, we did havan, what we call in our tradition, havan, just a method through which we remember the sacrifices of anybody and remember the soul by conviction we feel, Hindu conviction we feel, that his soul gets whatever my good wishes are there. So this is the end. I don't want to address as much as I wish to address, because it is a mode in which I don't communicate you physically. I don't know the reaction of your face. And unless the communication is there, one can't be very free in expression. But I wish you all the best, my young professional, IFS professional. You do your duty and be immortalized the effort and deeds of somewhere. Sanjay will live and remembered by you, by your deed, not by the face that will you every year we organize the memorial lecture and that. Deed is more important than the physical presence. So with these words, I express my gratitude to Indira Gandhi Forest Academy for giving me an opportunity to address you all. And also, though I don't see the clear-cut face of all that, but please do remember wherever you are. And I assure you that wherever you will go, whenever some of forest officers will come, I will feel that my Sanjay is there with him and he is with me. That is the only satisfaction which one can get in life. And I'm getting that because of your institute and various other institutions who are doing the work and immortalizing the deed of Sanjay. Thank you very much, my friend, the director, the faculty member, the new professional officer, and I hope you will do your best in your life, and you will remember by your deed that, well, Sanjay was one of your colleagues who did such a work that he has immortalized himself. I remember one incident, the first meeting was there, and when Director Forestry was there in the meeting, I was very sad. Naturally, that was the first year when this memorial lecture was on, my sadness, he felt it, and he said that, sir, you see, he was the chief, number one man of the forest department. Balu was also there, and he said that tomorrow I am going to, after some time, I am going to retire. I will be settled in Dehradun, but no old remember. But every year on 15th of February, Sanjay will be remembered, not here only, but all over the country I brought even. So this is the one satisfaction which I can get. I am happy that satisfaction is because of the deed, not because of the face and anything. I believe each one of you should be a special in your life, and in that way only you can say that, well, there was your friend, there was your colleague who did something, and it is the deed for which he is being remembered on his bill. Thank you very much, Mr. Director, the faculty member, and all that. And the Pramodji, he was very prompt. Lady, madam also, who is organizing the, who is in charge of the session, she made call to me several times, and I'm happy that you love me so much. I love you as much as you love me, and I assure you that wherever you will be and where I will go, I will remember you, I will call you, and when you call me, I will always be there with you. I feel that wherever I will go, I will be remembered by Sanjay, and whenever may I need you, you will be beside my side. This is the only satisfaction that a parent of Sanjay can feel. My wife is also here, but she is not going to address it because time, I understand, the program I have seen, and the time is so very short. Anyway, I express my gratitude to Madam Excellency, the Pandicherry, Kiran Bedi, and Director, the faculty members, new professional and all that. This is all that I have to say. Good luck, all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for your such a motivational address. We, the Foresters fraternity, have a firm belief that his supreme sacrifice and the principles upheld by him will continue to inspire and motivate foresters at various levels for selfless protection and conservation of forests for the humankind. So for the gathering, I would like to add that these memorial lectures are organized by IGNFA to commemorate the selfless deeds of these officers for responsive and committed forest governors, which not only made the entire forest fraternity, but the country proud of. Thank you, sir. So we have today with us Dr. Kiran Bedi, Honorable Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry, who will be delivering the 20th Sanjay Kumar Singh Memorial Address and interact with the probationers. Ma'am will be joining with us shortly. Before that, I will be giving a brief intro about the ma'am. Dr. Kiran Bedi, the retired Indian Police Service officer, social activist, and former tennis player, is the incumbent Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry. She is the first female IPS officer and started her service in 1972. She remained in service for 35 years before taking voluntary retirement in 2007 as Director General, Bureau of Police Research and Development. Many of us doesn't know that Dr. Kiran Bedi is a tennis player, and she crowned the national junior tennis champion in 1966. Dr. Kiran Bedi started her career as an assistant superintendent of police in the Chanakyapuri area of Delhi and won the President's Police Medal in 1979. In West Delhi, she brought about a reduction in crimes against women. As Deputy Commissioner of Police of North Delhi, she launched a campaign against drug abuse, which evolved into the Navjyoti India Foundation. In 2003, Dr. Kiran Bedi became the first Indian and first woman to be appointed as the head of United Nations Police and Police Advisor in the United Nations Department of Peace Operations. She has been honored with the UN Medal for Outstanding Service. She has written several books and runs the Indian Vision Foundation. In 1994, Dr. Bedi was awarded with the Raman Magsaysay Award and also the Nehru Fellowship. The Magsaysay Foundation recognized her leadership and innovation in crime control, drug rehabilitation, and prison reform. Now, even as the Lieutenant Governor, she opened the gates of Raj Nivas to the public, thereby making it as the People Nivas. Ladies and gentlemen, now Honorable Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry, Dr. Kiran Bedi ma'am, will be joining us through virtual platform. Join with me in welcoming ma'am. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
I am Ram Sundar, IFS probationer of 2019 batch, ma'am. Going to Bihar cadre. On behalf of Indira Gandhi National Forest Academy, I welcome you to this interactive session and memorial lecture, ma'am. Ma'am, with your permission, I would like to start the most awaited session, ma'am.
Please do.
Thank you, ma'am. The IGNFA, being alma mater, annually conducts memorial lectures in the academy in recognition of the services and bravery of Sri Sanjay Singh, Sri Srinivas, Dr. Manikandan, and many other foresters who have made supreme sacrifice of their precious life in the service of forest and wildlife protection. The current memorial address is the 20th in the series, is being held in the memory of late Sri Sanjay Singh. Ma'am, the faculty members of Academy, IFS probationers, as well as the senior forest officers and scientists at Dehradun are attending the session. The parents and family of late Sri Sanjay Singh are also attending the session, ma'am. Dear ladies and gentlemen, I now request the director, Indira Gandhi National Forest Academy, to deliver the introductory remarks.
Honorable Lieutenant Governor Dr. Kiran Bedi, ma'am, Professor Ghanshyam Singh, and family members of Shahid Sanjay Singh, dignitaries and invited audience, IGNFA faculty, officers and staff, dear IFS probationers of 2019 and 2020 batch. This is a significant occasion in the solemn memory of the supreme sacrifice of Shahid Sanjay Singh. We recall on this day the valorous values of Sanjay Singh, an IFS officer of 1991 batch. He relentlessly served the cause of forest protection beyond call of duty and had to sacrifice his life on 15 February 2002. Each year on this day, the Academy pays tribute to this inspiring legend of the IFS fraternity, and memorial lecture is organized in his honor. The IFS probationers undergo the embryonic stage of training at IGNFA. They are to imbibe and nurture the values of dutiful and ethical conduct, bravery, and fortitude of resolve and perseverance for the cause of their service, primarily the conservation of forests and protection of environment. Actions and disposition of righteousness and morality in matters big or small depend on courage of conviction, bravery, and selflessness. And Sanjay Singh was an icon of all these. We are grateful today to have with us for the memorial address Dr. Kiran Bedi, Honorable Lieutenant Governor Puducherry. We already know about her uniquely determined and unrelenting crusades for values of uprightness and in administration, governance, and her equally inspirational endeavors for social reform with human touch. It is a treasured opportunity for the probationers and the IGNFA community and all audience today to benefit from the inspiring address and words of wisdom of Honorable Lieutenant Governor. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, here's our most awaited moment. I request Honorable Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry, Dr. Kiran Bedi, to deliver the memorial address. Please, ma'am.
Are you getting my voice right?
Yes, ma'am.
Shri Bharat Joshi, the director of the Indira Gandhi National Forest Academy. Dr. Ghanshyam Prasad, father of, I don't want to say late, father of Sanjay Singh. All probationers of this prestigious National Academy. Nidhi, who's the convener, and Rahul, who also introduced me, and friends, and I believe family members also of Sanjay are present, paying homage, most respectful homage to them for having given such a principled and a brave son to this country. We all pay deepest regards and homage to this family and also to this brave son. It is the family which was the brave family which had produced such a son. Such children don't get produced overnight. They are a product of unstinted nurturance of the family. The entire family's investment goes into producing sons and daughters of this kind. Therefore, braver than the sun, sun is an offshoot of that banyan tree. Therefore, I would say the biggest, greatest respect to their parents, mother and father, I believe, even mother is present, and the family members. So Dr. Prasad, I have no words to explain. What can I say? Losing a son, but then your son lives beyond. I believe from the papers, Dr. Joshi, if it is true, that this family was committed to have been given the salary of Sanjay every month, and it's not been honored by the state government. If that is true, then I think that's our first duty to ensure that any commitment made to the family is honored. Am I right, Dr. Joshi? Is this Shri Joshi? Jyoti? Shri Jyoti, are you aware of that, Mr. Jyoti?
Sir, ma'am, I am not exactly aware of what was the commitment of the state government, but I will look into it, find out if there was issue like that.
Yes, the notes I have in understanding the event about Sanjay, that a commitment was made by family, that they would continue to give the salary. I think whatever was the commitment, verbal or in writing, I think we owe it to the family to see at least the commitment is honored. I have no doubt that once it's brought to your notice, it will be followed to the hilt.
Okay, ma'am. We will find out actually what was the commitment, and we will.
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Pursue that.
Yeah. Now, I have a second question to ask. You've got very many questions you raised, very useful questions, all of them, 15 of them. Now, if you want all the 15 to be answered, we'll have to go straight to the questions. Meanwhile, I'll just have to say, I have to ask another thing. Are your officers all in uniform when they are in the ground?
Officers, Indian Forest Service officers are not always, they don't have a uniform as such, but in the field outfits, they have field outfits like that.
But do they have a uniform called the forest uniform?
No. IFS officers do not have a prescribed uniform in the field or on the duty, like police officers. It's not like that.
I think a case is made out. When you read cases like Sanjay, a case is made out, Mr. Jyoti. They need the same kind of, almost similar kind of training as we get in the police or we get in the CRPF, because you are up against two kinds of enemies today. One is forest mafia, which is a plenty. And the other is the wild animals. Now, you have a lot of wildness in the forest. While you have an innocent community which is sustaining on the forest, living in one of the most nature-gifted environment. But I think a case is made out for officers to be having an Indian Forest Service uniform. I believe. I think it's not a case for civvies, even for officers to be in the forest. I believe they need a uniform. Because being in uniform to deal with mafia is very, very important. I think, please take it up if you can, that it's a case made out like this. Because you are dealing with violence. You're dealing with mafia and you're dealing with organized crime. And any forest officer who will deliver principally against the mafia, whatever kind it is, you are going to be dealing with organized crime. So you are not against an individual crime in the forest. Forest is all organized crime. And therefore, organized crime requires, say, you have forest warders, I know. But I think, do you have also Indian Forest Service police stations? Do you have police stations? Forest Service police stations?
We don't have that police station system. We have our beat offices, but that is not equivalent to police station or police chowki system in Forest Department, except maybe in certain protected areas and sanctuaries, there is an equivalent of that, but not on a regular basis. That is not the general arrangement.
My reading of Sanjay's case and also the notes which I have also makes me convinced that you need your own police stations, because you will never, ever Because one of the issues and questions raised here from the questions you've sent me is how do we get better police coordination? I'm not sure you will ever get it properly. Why? The reason is not that they wouldn't want it. It's because they are short of manpower themselves. So how much will they give you in a sustained manner? They will give you once in a while. So I think there's a case made out for offenses to be registered under the Forest Act in your forest police station itself. Investigations also taken up by having your own intelligence cell, because you are, in fact, service which is up against only mafia. You take up landmine mafia, you take up timber mafia, you take up mining mafia of any kind. It's all mafia, all that's organized crime. Therefore, you need a police station. There's a case made out. And I think it's time we make it out. And even your forest tribunals, even your forest court, where your forest offense is tried there, and the person is convicted or acquitted, and you have your own intelligence record system. I think you are a uniformed service. You are up in the wilderness. And therefore, you're totally exposed to wilderness. Therefore, you need to move into platoons. You need to move into issue like Sanjay will not happen. If Sanjay would have sections and he moves into section. You see, the Indian police service officer has armed police forces. And he moves with a section. He goes into a platoon. He goes with a company, the BSF, the CRPF, the ITBP. They don't work as individuals. I don't think Indian Forest Service should also be working as individuals. They need to move as groups, and they need to have trained manpower of a proper hierarchy. I would think these are the areas. I'm sorry, I do not know the first service, our Forest Service in detail. But whatever reading I've made of the Forest Service is the following. One, I think it's no less of the kind of a central police organization. It should be treated at par. Two, they need to have a uniform of a color designed. Three, they need to have armed police training. They need to have weapons of their own. You need to be trained in weaponry, whether it's attacking a wild animal or self-protection against a mafia. And that means you need to have reserve forces as well. Forest is environment today is the lifeline and the basic of any development of economic development. And there's bound to be a conflict between economic development and environment preservation. There's bound to be. So how do we strike a balance? And then the community, so therefore community policing, community foresting, we have community policing. You need to have community foresting, where if you are taking away certain things from the community, how does the community get rehabilitated? How does the community get upskilled? How does the community get cut its losses? So I think there's a case made out. If it is already made out, I'm certainly ignorant. I'm not an expert in this field at all. But these are my initial.
Just a minute. Our subordinate frontline staff, down the range officers, down the line, they are uniformed staff. They are a strong uniform team. And of course, we also have community forestry that we call joint forest management and eco development committees. So perfect. Through that, we do these community forestry activities. And but the higher level Indian Forest Service officers, they are not uniformed in that sense.
They should also be armed. They should have a weapon on the side. That means they need fire service training. Are they given any firing training?
Yes, weapons training, they are imparted.
Okay, fine. So whatever we are doing, if we can improve upon that basically means I want to avoid Sanjay Lai. I want to be prepared because Sanjay Lai case can happen again and again. Whatever Sanjay went through is not going to be the last and not going to be it's going to be recurring. The kind of controversy, the kind of strife and conflicts we are moving towards. Hostility and dire necessity of saving their own economies and their own vested interests and monopolies is going to become fiercer. And therefore, to handle the fierce hostility, which is likely and it's going to be challenged. And number two, with forest being more under at the moment pressure. So you can even be under a threat from the community. So I would think we need to arm better, uniform better, prepare better, have better reserves for them. So he had Sanjay had security, but not enough. He should not be moving around like that. Dealing when particularly, now, Mr. Jyoti, what I would like to say, any forest officer who challenges a status quo and it leads to a mafia should immediately be reported to the head office, and head office must not allow him to move alone. They need to be together as a section. So it's important that we, so that Sanjay's case, Sanjay-like cases are not in any way deterred. They actually feel empowered that my department is, if he's taking on a challenge, then Sanjay-like cases need to be protected. Have a section move. So he does not move alone. He moves as a section, as a convoy. And he talks, and there's also an intelligence wing. I'm sure you must be having an intelligence wing. So that intelligence wing continues to say who's under threat, who's gaining hostility. And therefore, it's like the armed forces, you have your reserves, etc. So I think investments require to be made into the service. That's my opening statement, Mr. Jyoti.
Okay, from
whatever
fine,
little, whatever little, but the people who would obviously love a forest, want to serve the country, and obviously want this kind of service would join the service. Otherwise, why would we? Like those, one should not stray into such services. It should be a chosen service. Like the police should be chosen, army should be chosen, forest should be chosen. It should be a preferred, your chosen service, or a service which you accept heart and soul. Because once you're in it, then you cannot be two steps forward and three steps back. You got to go on forward march. You got to keep making inroads into the forest for whatever reason. So therefore, you are the protectors of divine nature. And therefore, whether it's water, even water protection is coming under forest. So I would say, please look at even water, not just the trees, but the water. Because water conservation, including in the forest, be reported back if somebody is stealing it away, because that's critical. However, and then like water bodies being covered up and being water bodies being lost. No way. Forest must report. Because water bodies gone means you're drying up of the water table. So there's nothing called exclusivity in nature management. For me, this is not forest management. It is Indian Nature Service. In fact, it's World Nature Service. It's called Humanity Nature Service. You are in the lap of nature, which whatever nature comes, forest is nothing but nature. But forest for me is not trees and wild animals. Forest means the entire nature. And in that nature, whatever comes. But report. If you can't deal with it, don't worry. Report. But there must be reporting that this water body is being taken away and being filled up. Pond is gone. Lake is gone. Now it's a building coming up. No way. It should be reported. But again, as I told you, it'll be mafia. And that's not our beat. But at least reporting should be done. You can't say this is not my job. As I said, it's Indian Nature Service. All right, let's go to your question, sir. Who's going to ask me the questions? I've got the questions.
Yes. Thank you, ma'am. Now we can open the floor for interaction. Let me start with the first question. Ganesh, please.
Good evening, ma'am. Hope I'm audible.
Yes, it is. You are audible.
Ma'am, good evening, ma'am. Myself, Ganesh, you are, ma'am, 2019 batch IFS belonging to the Chhattisgarh cadre. Ma'am, the question was originally echoed by a frontline uniform forest staff of mine. Her name is Pratima Rajput. When I told her about this privilege opportunity to interact with you, she said, as uniform field staff of forest department, they work in some of the harshest conditions, testing conditions, all the while shattering the glass ceilings, which we all know are there. She, as the first woman IPS officer of the country, what message do you have, ma'am, for our brave lady officers in khaki in the field? Thank you, ma'am.
My short answer is you have no choice but to remain fighting fit. Fighting fit means mentally and physically, and be very agile, be professionally very competent, stay courageous, because you are a leader and you have to lead all others, and you are a decision maker. So you're rolled in one. You're a leader, you're a trainer, you're all everything in one. Therefore, remain fighting fit. There is no compromise in the service, like in the policing. If you compromise, you'll be hit from behind. You'll be hit from behind by an animal or a man animal, because there are man animals also in the forest. They're also animals. Maybe some animals are even better than that man mafia animal. So I would say my message to the women who are in is that remain very fighting fit and agile. There's no scope for you to wait, gain weight. You got to be runners. You got to be marathoners. And when you have become mothers, you got to get back to fitness as soon as possible. And number two, you need to have strong family support to handle your home, because there's no place for sharing it. You are in the forest, you're in the forest. So therefore, I would say it is very demanding service. In fact, this is more demanding, if you ask me, than the Indian police service, because you are into the wilderness. You're not always near the city or in the forest office, forest guest houses. So you may have to camp in the forest. Therefore, I would say remain fighting fit. This is the same thing to the men as well. It applies to men and women. It's no different. But the woman is different because she chooses to become, when she chooses to become a mother, she has to, she increases her responsibilities. When she increases her responsibilities, her attention is divided. And there is no scope for division of attention. She must go in for very support, strong support systems before she decides to raise a family. And she must ensure that the person she marries fully respects what she does. Fully respects, and not a demanding man, not a commanding man, but a supporting man. So these are my messages. Question number two.
Good evening, ma'am. I am Nisha Kumari, IFS Probationer 2019 batch, belonging to Andhra Pradesh cadre. Ma'am, my question is, a motivated staff is an important asset for a leader. Given we are not in daily touch with our last level field staff, we'll be grateful if you could share your experience and insights on how to maintain the motivation and discipline.
Maximum use of technology by maintaining communications. Forest office, you must stay in touch with fact by FaceTime, by virtual. Now today technologies on your side. Earlier you did not have. Earlier we did not have WhatsApps. We did not have drones. We did not have dongles. We did not have internets. We did not even have land phones reaching them. You have today mobile phone. So you are in touch with the mobile phone with everybody. That means you make collective calls, voicemails, virtuals. Stay in contact. You must stay in contact. And when you are physically present, connect and meet and listen. That is the way. The more you listen to your staff, the more they will remain aligned with you. So eat with them, play with them, train them, listen to them, converse with them, meet their families. All this is part of motivation. Motivation is not a lecture. Motivation is how you lead by a practical example, by physically being there. It's not a lecture. Be motivated, be happy, be... No, no, no. Eat with them, play with them, listen to them, look after their children, see if the children are settled, are the children fine, are they safe? This concern for them, it's your concern for them that will motivate them. Not an expression saying, hum aapke liye hain, hum aapka bahut dhyan rakhte hain, bada acha, karke kya kar rahe ho? Karke dikhao. Kuch karke dikhao. Bol ke nahi, karke. Tab banoge leader, nahi to nahi. Okay? So use technology to the best. Make sure everybody has a WhatsApp and you do virtual calls regularly, one-to-ones. So you must stay in touch with your wards and not lose track of them and lose them. You should know them by name, by face, and call them by name so that they know, madam mujhe janti hai. Madam ke bachcho, mere to bachcho ko bhi wo janti hai. So we must stay in contact. You must... Emotional connect does not come without this heart to heart, not head to head, heart to heart. So it's the emotional quotient which should play a little more role rather than only intelligence quotient, because it's the humanity in you, the compassion in you, sincerity in you, of sincerity in conversation. And then look at the service matters. Kisi ka increment ruka hai. Look at them. Take care of them. Take care of their family. So families are very neglected. They may be in your not village, your other village. Talk to your colleague and say, look after my colleague's family there. It's the way army does. Army doesn't distinguish. Army looks after any force, army soldier. So they are also your army. So look after them. You must look after their welfare. Next one.
I request Kasturi to Kasturi. Kasturi, please.
Third question, please.
Good evening, ma'am. Myself, Kasturi. I'm from the Assam Meghalaya cadre from the 2019 batch. Ma'am, your experiments in the Tihar jail were just amazing, as we all know, in terms of emotional intelligence and transformational leadership, ma'am. But ma'am, these stories would have got your own set of challenges, not only as an IPS officer, but also as a woman. Ma'am, could you please put light on both the aspects, the challenges that you faced being in the male-dominated field of policing, and also the advantages or opportunities that you had as a woman, especially in terms of restorative justice, ma'am?
You see, my challenges in the service have come from two levels. One level is my peers, which is my service, my colleagues, my seniors. That means men and women. There were no women at that time. The men in the service was my number one. Their mindset was their challenge. My challenge was how do I work with them? It was, that means coming back to me, how do I deal with my men? My men means my seniors. It was the men in the service, seniors, peers, and the juniors. So that was the challenge. So challenge was me, how do I deal with them? The second challenge was the people who were receiving my service. Now people are looking up to me. We will get good service from her. She'll be accessible. She'll not demand a transaction. People perceive women more honest. This is a public perception. They perceive women as she will be sunegi, baat sunegi, business nahi karegi. This is the bias or prejudice it can be. Women can equally be corrupt, no doubt. But the perception amongst the men, people are, women will be two things. One, more accessible. You can talk to her. Arey, hamare jaisi to hai. Itni badi baat kya hai? So they don't think that we are from somewhere. They say, hamare jaisi, she's meri jaisi. Choti si to hai. Chote kad ki hai, patli si to hai. Moti bhi nahi hai. So that's okay. So you have two kinds of challenges. One is this, your own servicemen. And the other hand is your beneficiaries, which means people. Now, how I deal with people is my character. Moment they start believing in me, you're winning them over. Because you are meeting their perception. That means the way I conduct myself, the way I serve them. Do I have integrity or purpose? Do I talk to them? Do I connect with them? Do they see me? Am I available? Am I understanding the problem? Moment I serve them, I win them over. I start winning them. Media starts reporting. Innovation starts getting. So people start trusting. Word of mouth. There's a word of mouth message. So you win them over. Or at least you don't have them as enemies. But you also have a vested interest even in there. Second is these peers. The peers who are yours, who are competing with you. Some of them are even competing with you. How do you deal with them? You can't change their mindset. Please don't go around thinking you can change their mindset. You just have to remain who you are. You have to go on working rightly, righteously, and leave no skeletons in your own cupboard so that they open saying, "Acha, tu hume ye bol rahi thi, ab tumhe ye dikhayenge." You don't have any chance. You have to be 100% upright and honest and professional to deal with them. Then there's a third category of men also, is a politician. Politician is the biggest vested interest in this country. And where even the politician becomes a vested interest, you are up for a bigger challenge. And the maximum he can do for you is to transfer you and threaten you. He will get you transferred. Take that as it comes. Never, never, ever say, "Nahi, mujhe help chahiye." Never take an obligation from a politician, because then he'll use you. So A, never get used. So take no obligation from any one of your seniors or politicians. because they will use you. Be ready to move. Just be ready to move. Don't worry about transfer. The day you start worrying about your transfer, you start compromising and you start being afraid. Your family should be very clear who's mommy, who's daddy. They are going to move and we're going to go. Finished. So that means no big furnitures, no big gifts. Keep your luggage light in the house so that you're ready to move. If you stay that way, you'll enjoy your service. But if you start collecting a lot of baggage, and now where do I take all this, all this, all this, then you start compromising. Then he start using you. And then you'll be afraid of taking decisions. And mafia also understands. So I would say remain light in assets. Remain happy with what you have. And number two, deal. You will not be able to change their mindsets, the politician or the vested interest or the mafia or your peers. But where you have good friends in the department, please network with them. Have your own support system. It's good to have friends in the service. You'll be lucky if you have good support systems. And have networked. Stay in touch with them. So that's your support, social support system. Family is your support system. But family should not be coming in the way to say, no, no, we can't go now. Mommy, let it be. Mommy, now allow. Mommy, do this. They'll say, beta, don't come in the way of my work. We have to move. We'll go somewhere else. But we'll be ready. So this would be my message. Now, keeping that in mind, that is the way wherever I could go, even in Pondicherry, I'm able to make the changes because I'm not afraid to go even tomorrow from here. I've not acquired anything here. I have no baggage except my books. So unless you stay light, they will say, oh, she wants to hang on. She wants to stay on. No way. I'm willing to go anytime. I'll go. For me, my life is more precious. My time is more precious. How I spend it is my choice. I'm given this work. I'll do my best. In nature, you have balancer. You have good people coming in your life and you got wicked people coming in your life. Life is nature balances things. In my life, good people came. I was appointed by the Prime Minister of India. He did not know me. I never worked with him. So good people also come who ask you, would you like to go as Lieutenant Governor Puducherry? In all my life, I'd never been asked ever, would you like to go as IG here or a DIG there? Nobody ever asked me. I just went wherever they gave me and I made the most of it, including the jail. Including the jail. I knew I was alone. I have criminals on one side. I've staff on the other side. The staff is criminalized to a large extent. There were good people there. Those good people became more good. The enlargement. Why? Because I started to lead the change. I start to deliver the change. And they start to realize I'm for their good. My intention is not to hit them or hurt them, but to heal them. So mine was not to hurt, hit, but heal. They realize, and healing means educate them, skill them, festival with them, sing with them, play with them. So when they realized over a period, it all changed. It became an ashram, bringing in. So what I'm saying is you are you must live under these realities. But the main thing is you have to remain transparent and strong and agile and physically fit. And your family should be your biggest support system. And your family means your in-laws, your parents, your children, your husband, your brothers, your sisters, and your even close friends. They are your strength, but they should not hold you back. They should be wind behind your sail. They should be strengthening you, not in any way emotionally weakening or blackmailing you. Okay? Next.
I request Agrim signing to ask the next question about forest police coordination.
Good evening, ma'am. Myself, Agrim Saini, 2019 IFS probationer at Maharashtra cadre. Ma'am, in my limited field experience, I have seen that there are often cases where forest department seeks help from the police. And whatever I have seen, police always provides help. But ma'am, my experience says that it's mostly ad hoc. It depends a lot on the personality of the officer involved on both the sides. Ma'am, according to you, what can we do to institutionalize such a mechanism at the ground level that it is not dependent on the personality of the officers involved? Thank you, ma'am.
It is from your question that I got this cue that you need your own police. It's from your question. When I felt, why don't you have your own police? You need to have your own police. When the government of India is creating so many police, India Reserve battalions, we can create forest battalions. A time will come, you have to create forest battalions, now or later. So I think a demand should start being made, a proposal should start getting be made. How do we now? And the ideal would be to recruit the locals, not take, don't take urbanites. The it's like in Chhattisgarh or Jharkhand, they've recruited local tribal girls and boys to become tribal force. And you don't need to train them much. They're so already very good. So ideally would be the recruitment of the forest could be from forest itself, who know the forest and who know it ins and outs of the way working. So I think from it's your question that I got the idea that why don't you have your own force? You, a day will come when you will need it. I think it should be mandated.
Thank you.
I request Ahmed Bilal to go for next question about Naxal threats.
Good evening, ma'am. Myself, Ahmed Bilal from Jharkhand Cadre. Ma'am, I went for my OJT in Jharkhand, West Singhbhum district. Ma'am, there just some months before me joining there, the range office was blown by the Naxals, and which led to a lot of loss for the forest department. Ma'am, in the absence of ammunition and weapon training of the lower personnel, ma'am, in the forest department, we feel crippled to deal with the situation. Ma'am, your suggestions on this issue?
Exactly from your question also, I raised these issues of concerns that you need your own parallel force. India Reserve Battalion, some of it should also be forest trained. So it's from your question that it made me worried. Why are we not trained? So we, that means more money, but I'm sure Government of India, once it understands and realizes it, you should make an appeal to the Honorable Prime Minister and to the Home Minister, whoever is in charge. You come under that Ministry of what? Forest.
Ministry of Environment, Forest, Climate Change.
So the Ministry of Environment should make a case for you. And Mr. Javedkar? Javedkar,
yes,
who's your minister? I think you should make a proposal to him. He should lobby for you. Sure. You need to start this proposal as a collective proposal. And such like cases will happen again and again. You'll never have police because police itself is so short. You need to have your own. And most of all, you got to be soldiers yourself. You got to be all soldiers, trained as if you are men in arms. You are comrades. You are combats. You combats. You need to be that kind of a policing for yourself, for self protection and protection of others, and not be taken by surprise. Okay, so it's from your question that I raise my concerns.
Thank you, ma'am.
I again ask, request Agrim Saini to ask the next question.
Ma'am, for any uniform service, motivation among the ranks is one of the most important thing that is needed for the effective functioning. And ma'am, often there is motivation among the ranks in any uniform service is one of the most important factor that is needed. And ma'am, often the forest field staff, which are uniform, they lack motivation. Ma'am, you have had a vast experience of commanding uniformed personnel. Ma'am, as young officers, what you will suggest us that how we should work to ensure that our uniform subordinates are always motivated and that motivation is maintained in perpetuity? Thank you, ma'am.
How do you motivate your children if you're a father? Are you a father?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Ask. Oh, all right. How did your father motivate you?
Like, he used to spend time with me and take me to lead. Introduce me to new things, buy books for me. It should always be available for me there.
You've given the answer.
Yes, ma'am.
You must remember, you are a parent as a senior. Never forget, you are a parent and a senior.
Yes, ma'am.
Am I right?
Yes, ma'am. Definitely.
So when you look at your junior, look at him, look at yourself as a parent. You may be younger in age, but you are a parent because you are a provider also. Parent is a provider, isn't he?
Yes, then ma'am.
Parent and provision, providing, sheltering, loving, caring goes all communications, visibility, care, right? Come together. That's all the same ingredients from a senior to a junior. No different.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. I request Kinga Nurbu to ask the next question, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Kinga Nurbu. I'm a foreign trainee from Bhutan.
Ma'am, as you have served in UN police, how would you suggest in enhancing intergovernmental and interdepartmental coordination in combating forest and wildlife crime, as these crimes are organized and transboundary in nature? Thank you.
Is that your question number 7? Especially during man-animal conflict, that's the one?
No, ma'am. 6, ma'am. Question number 6.
Question 6.
15, ma'am. 15, ma'am.
What is your question number?
15.
15, okay.
Yes,
ma'am. Last one, okay. Yeah. Oh, you talked about the UN police.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, all right. In the, I think internationally what is required, like in drugs and in narcotics, there's an international Interpol and it gives you a lot of UNODC. UNODC, the United Nations has UNODC. There's United Nations Drug Abuse Control, something like that. So they've got, and they've got Interpol. So there's international coming together of intelligence concerning drug mafia and organized crime in drugs. Do you have something like that in forests?
We have, but then the strength we have currently is still lagging. So we need to upscale.
That's right. That's right. Because that too is traded. Wild animal trade is international. So yes, an international agency, that means basically coming back to coordinated intelligence. So wherever you have next time, your major challenges in environment is coordination of forest intelligence or environmental intelligence, let's say forest intelligence. Secondly is the greater use of technology. Now you need to go greater use of technology, not only manpower and training and weaponry, but you also need technology. You need cameras. You need body cameras. So drones, these kinds of things we must use. So greater technology, greater training, greater intelligence coordination. And the UN body, which also shares this kind of international gangsters and smugglers of wildlife, because they are the real wild people. So it is answer lies in international cooperation and systems. I'm sure this could be taken up in the next international bodies. Again, this will be back to your minister. Back to your minister to take it up at a higher level. Dr. Singh, Gansham Singh. There's a, we've lost. Okay, he's gone board now. Okay, done.
Yes.
Okay, so I've answered my question number 15. Next question.
Yes, ma'am. Next question is question number 11, ma'am. I request Aniket to ask the next question, ma'am.
Go ahead.
Good evening, ma'am. Myself, Aniket Vanway. I'm from the 2020 batch and belong to the Himachal Pradesh cadre. My question is that in present times of social media, there is a lot of media glare on civil servants. And ma'am, you have been the first female IPS officer. And considering this, the media glare has been much more on you. So every action that we do has certain positives and negatives. The media covers you positively. Sometimes there is strict scrutiny on us. So, and this affects our decision-making at times, may affect our decision-making. So what is the coping mechanism in these times of media glare that you have adopted over the period of time in your career experience, ma'am?
Learn to deal with media now before it's late. I grew up working with media. Let's say why? Because I was a tennis player from the age of 14. And I was on the sports page from the age of 16. And media, sports journalists were reporting about my tournaments on the sports page for almost a whole 8 months to 9 months of tennis competitive season. So I was dealing with media. I was already in the media. I was getting interviewed. I was also being questioned. I saw hostility. I dealt with media. I started my understanding of the media from teenage time. So when I joined the Indian Police Service, it did not change because I only shifted from sports page to the crime page. But I was an open person who would talk about tennis, who would not shy away from being given interviews, right? And I had also friends in the media because I was dealing with them. I was familiar with the media. For me, media was a very strong link between me and my parents to read the news. Whether it's radio, whether it's newspaper at that time, we didn't have much of television. We only had the black and white television, which was not national mostly at that time, till it came later. So what I'm saying is early understanding of media being is important. Therefore, learning time to understand media is now. You don't have to be hostile to media. You have to be just fair to the media. You have to be fair to yourself. You don't have to exaggerate. Don't stay much, but don't feel shy of the media, because media is a very important communicator between you and the people. After all, your service has to be conveyed to what you're doing to the people of the area, to the community of the area, the FM radio, the AIR. So don't shy away and send your junior to be interviewed. You must speak, but speak to the point. Organize your thoughts. Communication at such a high level is very important, and media plays a very important role. So therefore, I suggest don't shy. You will shy away from media if you're doing something wrong, or you want to hide, or you're favoring somebody wrong. Then obviously you'd say, "Main nahi kar sakta, tum chale jao." So what I've done with myself is to remain my right self. No manipulation, no padding, just tight. Murder has happened? Yes, murder has happened. What are we doing? We'll be looking into it. Have you caught somebody? Yes, we have. But we only have a suspicion. Names? I said no names yet. Is somebody involved? Not yet. So you see, answer that question that way. So if you say, "Abhi batayenge, shayad iska ho gaya, hum usko poochtaach kar rahe hain, is gaon mein chale gaye, us gaon ne ye bola," you don't need to give the story. Just say, "Yes, murder has happened. We are looking into where did we fail, if we did, and that we are interrogating. Haan, koi log pakde, phlane ko pakda, phlane ko pakda. Have you caught him? No, but we have some suspects. I have no names to give yet, but I shall let you know, because I do need people's support. But people are assured that we will be working on the right lines. We will not let the culprits go away." So once this kind of assurance and assertiveness and authenticity come, people believe you. Otherwise, they'll create a story that so-and-so is running away, not telling us, zarur police wale ne kara, uski marzab. No, you killed it. But supposing they still give a bad news, no harm giving a rejoinder the next day in few lines. So brevity and truthfulness without taking names and taking sides helps you. It builds your trust. This is what happened in my life. I've been to the point with the media, but media for me is a very important bridge between the beneficiaries and the administration. Otherwise, how will administration, how would people know? Because politicians don't tell them the truth. Politicians speak in their own language. How do they get to know? I don't know the Tamil. How do I connect? So I issue a blog. I write a blog on what I think needs to be done. And I write the blog and I release the blog. That's my thoughts. But otherwise, there's no way. I don't know Tamil and I can't hold press conferences. I don't hold press conferences unnecessarily. So I communicate through my blog. I communicate through my tweet. I communicate through my social media. So I communicate, but I communicate with restraint and with the fewer words and being authentic and no defamation, but telling the truth. So, but media management by you senior leadership is very important, which we are all wanting to shy because we are afraid of making a mistake. And we are afraid the senior may ask, "Ye kyun bola? Wo kyun bola?" Toh isse nahi bolta. Maine kuch bolta. But then in the process, you lose your own trust and credibility. So you have to be selective. Who can speak best at the moment? When it's time for the leadership to speak, please take your chance. But when it's for the junior to speak, let him. If it's credit, pass it on to him. If it's discredit, come into it. If it's problem, face the camera. If it's good, let the junior speak. Okay? Next.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Next is question number 12, ma'am. I request Vikram to ask the question.
Good evening, ma'am. My name is Vikram Suresh Nade, IFS OT of 2020 batch. I have a question that you have served in very diverse positions, starting from being the first woman IPS officer, then to UN and later on presently serving as Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry. And you have performed effectively and efficiently in every position. I want to know what are the basic principles, values and good practices that you are following that ensures efficient and effective performance in every diverse position that one can hold.
Answer is very simple. And that goes as an internal answer. What are you in the service for? Service for? What's the purpose of your service? Means, with what purpose in mind have you entered the service? If you have a purpose to serve and enjoy the work, then your whole method of working changes. But if your purpose is somehow to get a salary every month and maintain a home and secure their future to an extent, then you will always be in two minds. You will always be weighing a decision, should I take this or not? Will it affect my survival? So if survival, just the material survival, is your purpose, then you will never be courageous. But if your purpose is larger good, for the purpose for which you done, that's what Sanjay did. Sanjay had the higher purpose in, that's why he laid down his life. But Sanjay should not have got involved into argument at all. When I read about Sanjay, my one message learned, lesson learned from Sanjay's case is, don't argue anywhere. Don't get into argument. Don't avoid an argument, because there's no point arguing with this mafia. You say, okay, we'll consider. Aapki baat sun lete. Let me listen to you. Let me examine. Find out what we can do. Try and buy time. Try and gain time. So the point is purpose. Now, his purpose was integrity, serving with integrity, looking after. See, when he was being attacked, he said, mere PSO ko chhod do. He didn't want his security guard to be hit. He wanted, and that's why they isolated him, segregated him. Isn't it? Don't argue. Try and avoid arguments. You cannot win that argument. Try and just listen to them and say, okay, mujhe time dijiye, main jaake officer se baat karta hu aur dekhta hu aapke liye bhi kya kar sakte. Try and gain time and then come back and mobilize and then see what can be done so that you live and not die. None of you should die. You should live. Live for the next day, but without compromising principles, but going in for maturity and wisdom. You don't have to show your power. You are protected. That's why I want you to be surrounded by security, enough proper security. Don't argue. Don't argue. Don't say, I'm the best. I'm forest officer. I'm so and so. I can do this. No. I'm sorry. You have a point. Main dekh raha hu ki sand mining ho rahi hai. Aapka paisa bahut chala gaya. Kya ho sakta hai ki kuch aur hum kaam dhoond sake aapke liye? Kya sarkar se koi baat kar sakte hai ki aapke liye kya kare? ना कि नो मैं आपको पता नहीं, मैं फॉरेस्ट ऑफिसर हूं, ये सैंड माइनिंग हो ही नहीं सकती, या मैं करके दिखाऊं? तो कहते हुए करके दिखाओ, तलवार दिखाएंगे. सो नो आर्ग्यूमेंट, नो थ्रेट, पावर इज विद यू इन योर हैंड्स. सो आई वुड थिंक कीप द पर्पस इन माइंड बट विद मैच्योरिटी एंड विजडम, सो दैट हाउ डू प्रोटेक्ट योर पीपल एंड यू प्रोटेक्ट योर सेल्फ. सो इफ योर प्रिंस पर्पस इज बिफोर यू, विच इज टू कंटिन्यू टू सर्व एंड नॉट कॉम्प्रोमाइज, बट यू डोंट हैव टू आर्ग्यू. You don't have to compromise, but don't argue. So uncompromising, that is why you're not arguing also, because you also want to live for the purpose, isn't it? So I would say, keep your principles intact, keep your people intact, and keep your purpose intact. The three P's, the purpose, the people, and the principles. If your three things are in alignment, which is your purpose of service, the people before you and around you and behind you, and in the community, right? And that finally is your principles that you've grown with. That is what Sanjay did. Sanjay had the purpose. Sanjay had the principles. Sanjay had the people. But you see, those people couldn't save him. The community could not save him. Community was with him. Community was doing appreciation and wanting him. But people are powerless when it comes like that. So you need people. But remember, don't bank on them to protect you. Your protection is your own force only, because people are powerless. But you need people because you're serving them. Purpose is to serve the people. Purpose is to lead your force. So your people is people in the community and people in the service. Once you take care of them, then you're taken care of. But there comes your experience. How do you deal with such? You're not a coward. You're not running away. You're buying time. You're trying to gain time. How do you gain time? You need to ask yourself. I don't know. No two situations are similar. I cannot give you one answer for everything. But I'm only saying you have to win-win in such a way that you live for another day and yet achieve your purpose. Okay? Don't argue even with a politician. He will never make you win. सो डोंट आर्ग्यू, लिसन टू हिम, सेइंग मैंने सर आपकी बात सुन ली, मैं इसके बारे में सोच के आऊंगा आपके पास या बताऊंगा सर. उसको आर्ग्यू करना ही नहीं कि नहीं कर सकता, मैं नहीं कर सकता सर, नहीं नहीं कर सकता, मैं मुझे समय दीजिए मैं देखता हूं क्या हो सकता है. देन कम बैक एंड टॉक टू योर सीनियर्स, कम बैक टू योर कॉलीग्स, कम बैक टू योर फ्रेंड्स एंड फाइंड आउट व्हाट डू यू डू, गेन टाइम, रिकॉर्ड. अनदर थिंग आई वांट टू टेल यू, ऑल ऑफ यू मस्ट मेंटेन योर डेली लॉग, व्हाट हैपेंस टू यू, मेंटेन अ डायरी एवरी डे, राइट डाउन योर थॉट्स, व्हाट हैपेंड. It's a learning. It's a catharsis that you, it's your friend. Diary should be your friend. Okay, next.
Thank you. Sure, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Now, the question number 13. I request Abhijit to ask the question.
Good evening, ma'am. Myself, Abhijit KV, 2020 batch IFS professional. My question is, how can we improve community participation in environmental conservation efficiently in urban areas?
All eco clubs should be your constituency. Every school has an eco club. Every college has an eco club. Every university has an eco club. Please do virtuals with them. They are all eco clubs. They are nowhere near the, no forest officer I've seen goes to them. They are your constituency. Keep nurturing them. Regularly meet your eco clubs, schools, colleges, universities. They are your friends. They will love you. Finishing. So, got it? So eco clubs, find a way of doing environment club. Every school has environment club. Do a little essay writing, competitions, debates, your talks, exercises, walk trails. These are all adventures. So you are all into adventure. You be with them. And they will then, that's sending the message. No telling lectures, doing. Not speaking, doing. Make do with them. Biking, trailing, planting trees, water conservation. There's so many nice things. We've done many of these in Puducherry with the children. We formed eco clubs, we walked with them, we went trailing with them, we go biking with them, we do paintings with them, we do a lot of it's yours. In fact, this is yours. This is your domain. And through them, you'll create a whole constituency of thousands of youth in environment. Ask them to do what you want them to do. They will, by doing, they will love the soil. When they play with the soil, they value soil. They value the earth soil. Then you explain to them what the soil means. Then they love Mother Earth. The flora and the fauna. Explain to them. Tell them about story of plants, the wild animals, children. Tell them stories. And in the story, walk the forest. They will love you. They will look for you. So while the wild animals are in the forest and the mafia is in the jungles there, you in the urban, it's the children for you. Be with them. Find an opportunity and give them examples. No lectures. Children don't lecture. They'll yawn. If you lecture, they'll yawn. No yawn. You take them along. Adventures, forest adventures. They'll never forget all their life and they'll all be wanting to be Indian forest officers one day. Then you'll promote, you'll be brand ambassadors of your service. Right? Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
What else?
Thank you, ma'am. Can we continue? Two more questions, ma'am. Can we continue the interaction, ma'am? With your permission.
Depends on the kind of a question.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. If it next is question number 10, ma'am. I request Harveer Singh to ask the question.
Done. 10.
Good evening, ma'am.
Madam. Okay.
Good evening, ma'am. My name is Harveer Singh. I'm an IFS professional of 2020 batch. My question to you is, ma'am, one of the challenges in forest service is that of tackling the jungle mafias. Ma'am, since you are an IPS officer, I would request you to kindly guide us how to face this challenge so as to conserve our forest resources and protect our wildlife in a better way.
You're Ranjit, you said.
Harveer Singh, ma'am.
Veer Singh. Veer Singh, reading your question, I added. If you notice, I looked at that forest should have police stations of their own. Forest police. In fact, it was your question also which made me think for you. So answer is that you need your own forest police stations. I think you need to be in uniforms yourself. And you need to have your own since I'm making to face this challenge. It's basically to prepare your own self. You have to be very, you're soldiers. You're soldiers in forest. You see, our soldiers are at the borders. You soldiers are in the forest. What's the difference? And you are more lost than them. And they are in bundles. There are so many numbers. You are all by yourself. So you are more vulnerable. Therefore, you need to be having more uniform. You need to have a weapon, a uniform, and also having some reserves with you, and then having your own police station. Which... Okay, you got another question in between the internet switched off. Any other question, please?
Yes, ma'am. Last question, ma'am. It is the question number 14. I request Vishal Singh to ask the question.
Good evening, ma'am. This is Vishal Singh, IFS Probationer of 2020 batch. Ma'am, my question is regarding law enforcement in forests. Ma'am, the poor and vulnerable people, especially the tribals or the people who reside in the fringe villages around the forests, they have their livelihood activities or their sustenance activities, which are sometimes illegal also. Yet they do not harm the society or the environment that much. How do you suggest the forest officer should go by that?
Correctly project the situation. Government must get the grasp, not the report as it wants, a report as it's true on the ground. If you report correctly, it will lead to better application of the policy. But if you go by what... That's an ethical dilemma for the poor and the vulnerable. Or if larger economic development is happening and it's also for their good, then what's the rehab plan? Try and explain to them. Be convinced yourself. So you are government also, and you are people also. You're both. You're not only government, you're not only people. But try and find, is there a way out? Is there a via media? So talking to people, making them understand, I'm only giving you a tip off. I'm not an expert in everything, but I'm only giving you one bit of my mind when you posed a simple question. It's understanding the grasp, the thoroughness of the issue, full understanding of the process, so that you can defend what you want to say. But you must be truthful. Principles, people, purpose. Purpose, principles, and people. So your people, you've got your principles, and you had the purpose of coming. But there's also purpose in that change, isn't it? Is that purpose for larger good? Is that purpose for a vested interest? Is that purpose for an individual? You need to look at whose purpose are they solving? And is there another way out? Because you're the person on the ground and nobody knows the situation better than you. So don't go for secondhand reports. Visit the site yourself. Understand it yourself. The nuts and bolts. Then you will be more appreciated when you say something. It will have a conviction and not a report given from another person. Document it. Videograph it. Interview people, listening to them, and look at all option 1, 2, 3. So the more thorough you are, the more your view will be valued. You may win, you may lose, doesn't matter. But you at least have cleared your conscience that you did the right thing, isn't it? You owe it to your conscience first that you presented scenario 1, scenario 2, scenario 3 to the government for policy making. If you give only scenario 1, then Then they say he never gave us anything else. We've gone by what you said. So you say scenario one, scenario two, why, and scenario three, why. Okay?
Thank you.
I wish you all well and a lot of safety ahead and a lot of growth and a lot of prosperity and a lot of peace and success in your work.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for your knowledgeable and interesting interaction with us. We could see your empathy for the frontline forest staffs working in the wilderness. Now, I, on behalf of the everyone gathered here, with your request, I request Ms. Nidhi Srivastava, Additional Professor, IGNFA, to propose the formal vote of thanks for the 20th Sanjay Gandhi Singh Memorial Lecture. Thank you, ma'am. Please, ma'am.
It is a matter of great honor and privilege for me to propose a formal vote of thanks on behalf of IGNFA Faculty, ma'am. First of all, I convey my deepest gratitude to you, ma'am, for not only providing your kind consent, but gracing this occasion with your gracious presence and interacting with your institutional address and enriching interaction with IFS professionals. I'm sure that the professionals at the beginning of their professional career would immensely benefit from your message, ma'am. Thank you so much. My gratitude and heartfelt thanks goes to Dr. Ghanshyam Singh, Dr. Kanti Singh, parents of late Sri Sanjay Singh, and other family members for gracing the occasion with their presence. Thank you, sir and ma'am. My special thanks also goes to Sri S. Karthigan, IPS, Ms. Asha Gupta, Comptroller of Rajivas, Sri Joseph from Technical Team, and other officials of Rajivas for all their wholehearted support and prompt guidance in organizing this event and making this evening so memorable for all of us. Thank you, all of you. My sincere thanks goes to one and all here, all the dignitaries and the invited guests, all the audience and participants, including probationers, for attending this session. Thank you, one and all. Jai Hind.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. It's a job.
Thank you, ma'am.